Hello and welcome to Camino Talks. I am Caitlin from Follow the Camino, and today we're joined by Dries. Dries is the manager of Casa Alternativo, which is an albergue on the Camino Portuguese. Thank you so much for joining us, Dries.
You're welcome. Nice to meet you.
Fantastic to have you with us. So you're quite passionate about the Camino, obviously. You're running an albergue on the Camino Portuguese. Tell me a little bit about how you first fell in love with the Camino. What was your first Camino and why did you walk the Camino?
Well, my first Camino was, a lot of people, the Camino Frances. And it was because of my father. I was struggling in life and I was 33 years old, and I didn't know really what to do in my life. And my father said, walk the Camino. And he said, yeah, Dries, you really have to walk the Camino. And I said, yeah. And I'm not a walker. I like to walk to the bakery and that's it. And then he said, yeah, but you really have to do it. And it kept on being in my mind. And I said that one day I said, okay, I was so fucked up by the society and I didn't know what to do in my life. And I said, yeah, okay, let's do it. And it opened my world. I fell in love with the Camino and I really wanted to live on the Camino.
And so you started with the Camino Frances, but then yes. As you walked, you fell in love with it. And then you actually walked several other routes.
Yeah, so I was thinking about living on the Camino and I didn't know really what to do. And as I walked into Santiago, I will never forget it, the last few 100 kilometers from Sarria, it came in my mind. I had an idea. So I came in Santiago and I went back to Belgium to work on my idea. And then 3 months later, I went back to Pamplona, and I made pictures of the pilgrims and I turned them into postcards. And I gave them a number, the pilgrims, and the day after I transformed the pictures to postcards. And the day after I went further on the road and I sell the pictures to the pilgrims who I met the day before. And it was a donation and I lived on the street in a tent and I had a little studio to make my postcards with electricity from a very generous neighbor. And I did this for 3 months. So I sold postcards for 3 months and then I said, yeah, this is not a life, you know? And then I said, maybe I should start my own albergue. So I didn't have any money. So with the money I earned from my postcards, I said, after 3 months, okay, let's have an albergue. Let's look for an albergue because I could walk forever. But financially, it's not doable. So I said, yeah, maybe I have to bring the Camino to me. And that's exactly what I planned to do. And so with the little money, I said, okay, I'm going to start walking the Camino, other Caminos than the Frances, all the other ones, to find a house to start my own albergue. And I took a train to Irun and then I started with the Camino del Norte, the northern one. And so, yeah, I did the whole way to Finisterre, from Irun to Finisterre, but I didn't find a house. And then from Finisterre, I said, I promised myself, I'm not going home before I found a house. So I took a bus back to Oviedo to start the Camino Primitivo. And the Primitivo was a very nice Camino. It's one of my favorites, but there were few houses and I didn't have the money to buy a house. So I needed to rent something. And there are not a lot of houses on the Camino Primitivo, so I didn't find anything. And then I was really frustrated. I came in Santiago for the second time. And then I said, okay, I'm going to go for the Via La Plata. And then I took a plane from Santiago to Sevilla. And then I started walking back to Santiago. And there were a lot of houses to find in the Camino Via La Plata, but there were no pilgrims on this Camino. Oh, allez, there are, but it's not really, you know, you have a few pilgrims and to earn enough to pay a cost, it was pretty impossible, in fact. So I said, I came back in Santiago and I still didn't find anything. And then I had only 50 euro left on my bank accounts. And then I said, yeah, I promised to myself I'm not going home before I found something. And then I took a plane to Lisbon for 49 euros. So I came in Lisbon with 1 euro on my account. And then I walked the coastal way. And I went then through the central way there. And then I found a hostel, which called Quinta Estrada Romana from Jeff, was the owner. He was from Canada. And I told him everything. And he said, what a fantastic story. You know what? Why don't you start to work here as a volunteer? Then you know how it is. And then you can maybe find out the region and you have more time to find out, to look for a house. And I said, yeah, that's a great idea. So I worked there 6 months. And he was right, because then I had a base and I started looking for places. And there was one particular village called Orbenje. And this is right in the middle between Tui, the first little city you meet after the border in Spain, and Oporinho, the first etap. But between Tui and Porinho, there was nothing. And this is quite a large etap, you know. And I said, maybe I have to find something in between there, because there are no albergues over there. And so I was always going to this little town, Orbenje. And suddenly, one day, after 4 or 5 times, the whole little village, it's only like 200 people living there or something, and there's only one street. And I was always asking to people. The whole village knew me before I was there. And suddenly I was there for the third time, and I saw a little light burning on the mall. And they were working on a house, and I went there and I said, yeah, man, what's this? Ah, we're building a house to rent. And I said, what? And then I said everything from my dream. I said, I walk already 4 or 5 months, and I really want to do this. And he said, okay. And I said, what? And yeah, that's the way it went. So I said, yeah, when will the house be ready? And he said, in 1 year. So this was perfect. So I went back to Belgium and I worked my ass off 1 year and saved some money, but not a lot. And then together with a friend, I went to Orbenje. Because the house was finished, and I kept in touch with the boss a year. And I could say as well, it was very, very unusual, but I could say, okay, I want this there, and this and this. And everything he did for me. And we started going there, and without few money, we didn't have a lot of money. And then went to factories to ask for wood. And then we start building everything from wasted materials. So we built sleeping rooms, dorms, we built a terrace, we built a bar. And at the last day, I will never forget, I only had 100 euro left on my account. And that was the day that all the pilgrims came in, and it didn't stop. So every day it was full house. And for a half year, I did this. Before Corona kicked in, of course. Yep.
Wow, that's quite the story.
I said it a little bit. It was a long adventure, so I hope I said it in a short way.
No, that's great. And so you were operating for half a year. Corona kicked in. Suddenly, all of the pilgrims stopped. And you had gone through this whole process, and now you've are trying to get back up and running or trying to change the way that you were working from a donativo to a set price hostel. Is that right?
Yes. And to be honest, it's not the way I wanted to do it. I had a donativo for 6 months, but in fact, it's illegal to have a donativo because you have to work with associations. So for having a private donativo, it's very, very difficult. And so I needed to change. So I made from the time there was Corona, I had the opportunity to change everything to a legal, let's say, a legal business where you can have fixed prices. But I'm a pilgrim, so I know what pilgrims need, and I'm very low. I have to go up to 30 euro, but you have a dinner in the evening with wine and water. You have a nice bed. You have a very, very beautiful, nice environment. And in the morning, you have your breakfast. So for 30 euros, I think it's a good price.
Great. But you've had some difficulties with making that transition, and you're actually trying to do a crowdfunder now to get the funds together to properly transition into being a full business and to keep you afloat until the 2022 season properly starts. How's that going?
Well, it's very difficult in Spain, and especially as a foreigner. I don't know how it is as a local, but as a foreigner, I know Spanish, but I can speak Spanish, but the language they use for the laws, I don't even understand in Belgium language. So it was pretty hard, but I had a big support from the owners of my place. They are really supporting me. They became family, and so I came back to Belgium to work here to pay my bills there. Of course, I have to pay my bills here in Belgium as well, because I needed to find a house here as well. So, and that's why I said, yeah, maybe I should start a crowdfunding page where people, pilgrims, can donate something. And in return for their donation, they get a night for free with dinner and breakfast. And of course, when they are there, they can still donate something. But this is the way I tried to make it, because I'm not doing it to get rich, you know. I'm just want to live on a Camino, and I just want to make people happy and support them and give them very good advice about the Camino, because I know everything right now, because I walked so much. I almost walked 6,000 kilometers. So I just want to support people on the Camino. And it was very good, because I just launched it and there were amazingly a lot of people who wanted to support me, and it still goes on. So I'm very happy, and I'm leaving right now on Thursday to Spain. And next month, March, I think it will be around 15th of March, I will reopen my place again.
Fingers crossed. It sounds
that
like
you didn't know, Catherine. I think
it's on track to be getting there. So I know a lot of people, when they walk the Camino, they feel inspired. They go, gosh, I'd love to make this my lifestyle. I want to own an albergue. I want to run an albergue. I want to work on the Camino. Do you have advice for people who are thinking, wow, I'd love to make the Camino part of my life?
First of all, you really have to learn the language. This is the most, for me personally, it's the most important issue. And in fact, it is to learn the language, because there's a lot of corruption, bureaucracy. It's quite impressive how they are still hanging in the years 1980, and it never changed there. So you have to really build up a network from people around you. In your town or in the place where you found the house, you really have to have a network of people who support you. Because I'm lucky and unlucky, I always worked did this alone. Sorry, I always did this on my own, together with my big friend here. My friend Otto. So, and it was easier, you know, because then you only have yourself to think about. But you really need the support, otherwise you go down. And they always try to, how can I say, you really have to look to the law. And this was not in the beginning my first thought to, I wanted to have a free home and an open house and let come in and give what you want. But this is not how it works. I had inspection then. And then really I had to change everything to make a legal business. And now in fact, it was for an albergue, there were so many rules. For example, I had one bathroom. I needed two bathrooms, one for the man, one for the woman. So it's really like, come on, we are living in 2022. Why do we have to separate man from woman in the bathroom? But it's like that. I needed two bathrooms. I needed so much space for the pilgrims. You need like 4 square meters each pilgrim. And so for me, it was easier to change everything in a pension first star. And that's exactly what I did. So now I'm not an albergue anymore, officially. I'm a pension, 1-star pension. And when you have a pension, 1-star, it's the law is more easier. You know, you can have 1 bathroom for 2 rooms. And I only have 2 rooms for 4 people, so I only can host 8 people. So, and this was a side way to make my dream come true, in fact.
That's very interesting. Well, thank you so much for joining us. I do hope that you have the best of luck with your crowdfunder and that you're able to be up and open in the next couple of months. Okay. And thank you so much for joining us.
You're really welcome. And if I can say something, so my crowdfunding is still going on right now. Underneath the video, you will find the link to donate something. And each donator can have a free night with evening meal and breakfast. So you can also donate to give it to a fellow pilgrim who will walk the Camino as a gift. So it's interesting, and you can also find on the link, you can find my page, Casa Alternativo on Facebook, where you can like my page. And so you keep in touch with me.
Fantastic. And of course, also down below, we will have the link to follow the Camino for more content like this and to learn more about the Camino. Thank you so much, Dries. We'll see you all next time.
Excellent. Thank you very much.
Bye. Cut.